I'm optimistic. Oh, oh, I'm strangely optimistic.
Hello, everybody. It's Josie Davis, your host of the Imperfect Podcast. This is episode 3. And normally what I like to do is have fans call in and ask questions, and I help them with my sort of advice column. But today we have a celebrity guest that I'm really excited about, my sweet friend. Before I tell you who it is, because everyone's been very excited to know who it is, he was on, one of my favorites is, I'm going to give it away if I say, I'll mention my favorites for the last. Okay, first I'm going to say Transformers, Bombshell, Air Force One, Public Enemies, next I'm going to say Winning Time. He played Chick Hearn, and he's in Shonda Rhimes' next show. I would love to introduce Spencer Garrett.
Hi, Josie Davis.
Yes, I'm so excited. He drove all the way down.
The crowd goes wild all the way down from Los Angeles, California.
You guys, he actually drove here instead of doing the little...
Who drives in L.A.? Who does that?
Yeah.
Who gets in their car and drives?
If it's more than 15 minutes, I'm not doing it. But you were very kind to do it. I'm so excited.
I was going to take the metro and be green, but I decided no. Hi, Josie Davis. I'm a little embarrassed because I was almost going to wear the same thing. I did have very similar. It was a gold sparkly.
Oh, gold would have been really cute.
Yeah,
that's funny because I almost wore my little pocket.
Your little pocket square.
Yeah,
that's kind of my. I love a pocket square.
Very cute. You've got your vodka right here.
Got
mine. We're pretending it's water.
I feel very underdressed sitting next to you right now.
Well, this was, normally I don't dress up, but this is for him, you guys. I wanted to look fabulous, like a disco host. You've done Blevins' podcast. He's a friend.
Who's that?
Blevins, Ronnie
Blevins. Ronnie Gene Blevins. Yes, the character actor.
Ronnie Blevins.
Yes.
We became friends from social media, which you are on Instagram and Twitter. I can't believe you're a big tweeter.
I'm less of a tweeter now that the Mr. Musk has taken it over and it's turned into this kind of fiery racist hellscape.
Oh,
but I do like to jump on there from time to time and plug certain things. But I think that's where Ronnie Blevins may have found me. He does a great podcast about character actors and
that would be you.
That would be me.
Yeah, what a character you are, you guys. Yeah. He plays Chick Hearn in Winning Time. I mean, that is, and can I just save, I don't want to save the best for last because he has so many best for lasts, really. But remember the movie, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood?
Do we remember that movie?
Do you remember he played, and you were in.
3 years ago. I hope they remember it.
Well, there's so many things that you've been doing that it's a little ridiculous.
It's also one of my favorite movies, too. I love that movie.
Quentin Tarantino directed it. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Brad Pitt and Leonardo were in it. And your character, what a job.
That was fun.
I mean, you were killer in that. And I love that it only took you an hour or so to shoot.
Something like that. Yeah, I was on the set. I remember I had like a 6 a.m. call. I went through hair and makeup. I was on the set by 7:30, and I was done. I was back in my car by 9, and I was driving down the freeway thinking, wow, did that just happen? It happened very quickly. But we did sort of one or two takes of each set up with the boys, with Brad and Leo, and then a turnaround on me, and then Quentin asked me to come up with my little sign-off, my Alan Kincaid sign-off, and it was it. It was done. It was over, and Quentin shoots on film, and so whenever they change the film mag, somebody would come around with a little tray of little mini margaritas while they were waiting for the film mag to change, and I remember wrapping my scene and everybody sort of clapping and saying my goodbyes, and it all happened so quickly, and that some guy came around with a tray and handed me a little margarita, and I said,
"That's
my little wrap margarita," and got back, little shot glass of margarita, and got in the car and drove home and on to the next gig.
It is weird when they throw you in, and it's usually like that when they're big stars like that. You're in and out.
It was kind of in and out. It was strange. I hadn't met Quentin. I auditioned for it 8 months earlier.
And this was in person or self-tape? I can't remember.
This was with an amazing casting director, Victoria Thomas, who does all of Quentin's movies. And she's been kind of a champion of mine, a terrific casting person. And I went in, read with her, and she gave me a couple of little directions, a couple of little tweaks. And I sort of sitting in a chair, and I did this thing where I swiveled around the chair and looked to camera and And it was done. And then 9 months later, I got the call that Mr. Tarantino wants to see you.
So. You kind of knew you got that after that.
Kind of did. I had a good vibe. You don't always. I mean, I've been doing this a long time. You get a good vibe when you walked out of the room and it was just Victoria and I, and I kind of walked into my car and I thought, hey, I think I'm going to get that.
How long have you been doing this?
73,000 years. Now, I've been doing it. I did a little bit of it when I was a kid.
Did you start at 25?
I kind of started in earnest when I was 25, but I did some when I was a kid. I did some after school specials and movies of the week and stuff when I was a little kid growing up, but I didn't really I wasn't a kid actor. I really didn't start doing it for real until I got out of college and I moved out here from New York. And
that was Air Force One. Was that what was your first job?
That
was your big job.
That was the first big job, but that was the first time I got invited to sit at the grown-ups table and be with real movie stars in a real
That's
big movie.
That's so huge.
It was pretty. I'd done a couple of films before Air Force One. Air Force One was 95. And I'd done, I think, sort of George of the Jungle and a couple of little indie things, but nothing on that scale. I mean, that was my first big time Hollywood movie. I mean, Harrison
that's
Ford,
a
Glenn
dream.
Close, Gary Oldman. So that's kind of when I thought, oh, I just got invited to the party on this one. So that was kind of a good feeling.
You come from the whole family of actors.
I mean,
Doing theater on the Showboat in Mississippi?
Yeah.
On the Mississippi River?
My grandparents had a theater on the Goldenrod Showboat on the Mississippi River in St. Louis. And my mom and my aunt were both actors as little kids. And the Showboat would go up and down the Mississippi River, and they would stop in little towns. And the people from the towns would go and watch a show in the theater, and then they'd go on to the next town. So that's,
no wonder you bleed acting. I mean, he's one of those actors that's acting is coming out of every orifice.
Every single orifice. I'm just bleeding out of my sweat, bleed,
yep, all of
sweating,
it.
Sweating, bleeding out of every orifice.
I mean, you're a real
acting.
Actor.
I guess so.
I was a real actor. I feel like I'm not even a real actor.
No, I'm still trying to figure it out. I mean, I'm 35 years into this insanity.
But it's in your family, that's so bizarre. I mean, mine, it's just one generation. Yours were, that's crazy.
Yeah, three generations, but my aunt, my uncle, my mom, a couple of my cousins. It's crazy. It's a family, kind of a family business.
It's a family disease.
Yeah. It's a family disease. More of a family
disease. It
really
is. It's
business.
The gift that keeps on giving.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm trying to stop the bleeding from the orifices. I'll let you know how that goes.
This is my third episode, but only the second time I've been here, because I did two in one. So I just hit my face on the microphone. And then my hand. So I'm new at this. So forgive me. You're forgiven.
It's a very professional, big time showbiz Hollywood
set.
Yes,
cute?
I like
Aren't you glad
candles
you came in person?
And I can smell
the rose.
The lovely rose. Mm-hmm. The lovely rose. And now are we plugging these items
here? No, but we're plugging my skirt. It looks like I'm in a pile of a blanket there. Okay, I'll sit up straight. This is Gigi Moda. Why are we talking about this right now? Sorry. Do not shop Gigi Moda unless you're a woman. Let's not get into this.
Not for boys. It's not for the men.
Well, there are some, I guess.
I'm sure there's
some
men that would enjoy that.
Yeah, it's a flapper type thing. But so I've only met Brad Pitt once. Mm-hmm. You've met him.
I met him. We worked together. I mean, when we were on Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. He said, I know I've seen you in a million things. He said, have we ever worked together before? And I said, you would have no memory of this, but you and I worked together on Dallas. For those kids out there who are old enough to remember the television show Dallas.
Wasn't Victoria Principal on that?
Was via Victoria Principal and Larry Hagman. And
we have a lot in common. Sorry, go ahead.
It was a big nighttime soap opera in the late 80s, early 90s. And so Brad was on the last three episodes of Dallas. As a 18, 19-year-old kid, fresh off the bus from Missouri. And it was one of my first TV gigs. And so we didn't have any scenes together, but we were both in those last three episodes. And I said, you wouldn't remember me from Dallas. And he said, no, but I just feel like we've worked together before. And then Brad and Leo started talking about, DiCaprio said, you were on Dallas? And Brad said, yeah. He said, and Leo was like, I did a Falcon Crest and I did a Matlock and... Like coming up in the business when you're a young actor. There were these sort of rites of passage shows that you did. You did a Matlock and a Murder, She Wrote and a Falcon Crest. If you're lucky enough to get on these nighttime soaps, Murder, She Wrote was like the badge of honor. So I sound really fucking old right now.
Wow.
Really,
no, that was not our, and Leo and we were kind of in that same little circle then also, but we did a lot of red carpets together and stuff. So I know him in a very different way.
Sure.
Than you working
back when
with
he
him
was doing like,
it was before he
pains?
Got growing pains.
Oh,
no,
wow.
He was just going to red carpet events and we had the same publicist.
Okay.
He and Toby and I, we all used to know each other.
Yeah. Yeah.
Gilbert and that whole little group, you know,
yeah.
It's bizarre.
Yeah.
But I only met Brad Pitt once. You actually worked with him. So that's better than what I did. I met him. He's very nice.
He's very nice.
Very
it's,
nice.
It's a shame that it's amazing that he's managed to do so well with all of his physical limitations.
Yeah, because he's not very attractive, but I'm sure there are other things that people could look past.
Like the two guys were sitting across from me and they're smoking cigarettes. and they were in character and they were smoking unfiltered like Pall Mall cigarettes. And Leo said, so you want to smoke? And I had quit smoking like 10 years earlier.
Good for you.
And, but no, I said, yeah, sure. Leo DiCaprio's asking me if I want a cigarette.
I'll start again.
I'm going to start again. So I lit a cigarette right before we shot this scene. And I literally, I took a hit off of this Pall Mall cigarette and I was high off my ass.
Oh my God.
So, and then, you know, action. And I'm like lightheaded.
Did it before you acted?
Right. I just
took
two puffs off the cigarette
after
and I was
smoking
ripped.
For years. That's insane. Yeah.
Well, that's right. It'd been like 10 years.
What are you going to tell them? No.
You know, and they're like smoking away. They're like chain smoking these things. And I literally took one sip off of this cigarette and I was just bombed.
That's hilarious.
So, yeah.
Well, who would know? My God.
I got through it.
And you can't hide your intelligence. My God. The guy, I don't know if you've, have you ever played anyone stupid? Because you're like brilliant in everything. I mean, you play a brilliant, intelligent man in everything.
You're very sweet.
Have you ever played a dumb guy? They're fun.
Dumb guy. I don't want to judge my character. I wouldn't say on camera on a podcast that millions of people are going to listen to that Sean Hannity is a dumb guy.
Who's getting political here?
But I have played.
Aren't you dating a Dana Bash?
Dana, yes.
I'm sorry.
That's
Dana
okay.
Bash.
Dana Bash.
I like her, by the way.
I do too. I'm very fond of her.
Now, I'm independent, so I don't get political on this show. We had to cut that. I got political at one point.
Oh, yeah. We don't have to go down
about the world and the war.
She's a reporter at CNN. She covers politics.
Yeah,
CNN,
yeah, yeah.
And we have a no politics rule.
Of course.
I'm not allowed to talk politics.
And he shouldn't. Yeah. But I did about what's going on. I lost 8,000 followers, which is fine. They're not going to hold my hand when I'm dying on my deathbed.
They'll hold your head when you're dying. But
not my hand. Yeah, thank you so much. So I don't care.
But Sean Hannity, I've actually played a lot of real life political figures.
You have played 10? Is that right?
Who played what?
You have played 10 real people.
Did you count? Did you look on the...
Do you think I have not researched
that's
you,
amazing.
My friend?
Is it 10? I don't know the actual number.
I think it is. I think
really?
That you did say to someone at some point
in
time 10.
I played Tom DeLay, Congressman Tom DeLay, who was a corrupt Republican congressman.
God, he makes a good congressman. Wonderful.
Corrupt Republican congressman. It's almost redundant, but...
We're not getting political.
No, we're not getting
ladies
political.
Ladies and gentlemen. We're not. I'm independent. That's all.
Tom DeLay in Casino Jack. I played Senator Joe McCarthy, the famous red baiting communist hunting senator from back in the 50s. I played Bob Woodward. I played Sean Hannity. Obviously,
how do you remember all
those? I can't. Those are four. But I think there's something like
Chick Hearn.
Well. Chick Hearn.
You are adorable. You're an adorable
Thank
Chick
you.
Hearn.
Thanks.
Even though he's telling Adrian Brody to shut up, basically.
With my fist.
In it. It's
yes.
really fun. Stop talking.
Yeah.
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 I dated a guy that looks just like him. He gets right.
Looks like Chick Hearn or
almost
Adrian Brody?
Exact. No, he looks almost like Adrian Brody. And people come up to him all the time.
Oh, yeah?
Are you Adrian Brody? Yeah. And Bombshell.
Yep. Bombshell.
You know,
as Sean Hannity.
Big fan of that movie, right?
Yeah,
and
me too.
You loved Charlize.
We love Charlize.
Right?
Quick Charlize
I'm a
story.
Fan.
I got the gig. I walked onto the set. Jay Roach, wonderful director. My third or fourth time working with Jay. And he introduced me to Charlize, who was not in makeup. She was not in character at the time. And again, an unattractive, you know, physically.
I know. I feel bad for her, but at least she's a great actress.
No, again, it's like staring into the sun. As soulful and sweet and lovely and kind as she is beautiful.
Big fan.
And a tremendously gifted actor. Mm-hmm. And Jay introduced me. She was lovely, gave me a hug. And then I didn't see her again for like 3 or 4 days later on the set. And this woman, this tall blonde woman, was standing next to Jay on the set. And I came over and said hi to Jay. It was my first day on set. And I'm chatting with Jay as this woman is standing next to him. And he said, "Don't you want to say hi to Charlize?" And I went, "Oh my God." She was in full.
I thought it was Megyn Kelly.
I thought it was Megyn Kelly.
I was ignoring her because I thought it was.
I wasn't ignoring her, but I thought she was they're coming.
Siren.
They're coming for you.
Yeah.
They go. They're coming for you.
But I thought you'd ignore her because you thought she was, you know, Megyn Kelly.
Yeah. No.
Did you ignore Megyn?
I did not. Would I ignore Megyn Kelly?
I don't know. Are we getting political? You're not allowed. Hey.
I might. Yeah. Okay. You give me the fist. All right.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
But it turns out it was Charlize.
It was Charlize, and I did not recognize her at all. And she said, "Hi, Spencer, it's me." And I went,
Spencer,
"Oh my God!" But that's how it's uncanny. Her voice and her physical transformation as Megyn Kelly was astonishing. And that's how you get an Oscar.
And you weren't too shabby, were you?
As Sean Hannity,
yes,
I looked like a schmuck as Sean Hannity. I had this.
You had the wave.
I had that little barbershop quartet haircut with the little stupid part in the middle.
But you made sure you had like the little
flip.
Yeah.
In fact, that was a big thing. Wonderful Ann Morgan, the hair designer on that show. I've worked with a bunch of times, and I was very specific about it. I need the.
You
swoop.
Have to. Yeah.
I kept saying, "Give me the swoop." So he's got that little swoop. And that was what every morning in makeup, and I would see the little swoop. I was like, "That's it. All right, there's Hannity."
I would like somebody to give me the swoop,
would
but
you?
It doesn't happen. Anyway, it makes no
sense. I'm not going to touch that.
I'm just being silly. okay, so that's this kind of show. Yeah. That's what this show's about. It is imperfect. Okay, so I wanted to ask you about you trained with Sandy Meisner, right?
I did, yeah. The actual guy.
Yeah? The what year was that?
That was in from the late 80s through the early 90s. I met Mr. Meisner when I was 21, and he had a home on the island of Bequia in the West Indies, Bequia, in the West Indies, and you had to fly, you flew to... the Bahamas or something, and then you took a little puddle jumper, or as I like to call it, Buddy Holly Airlines. You took like a little tiny little prop plane to this little island, and he lived on this island, and he would take 20 students there every summer.
This sounds like a very suspicious little trip, doesn't it?
No,
does it remind you of something?
what? Lord of the Flies?
What are you talking about? What? Oh, yeah, sure, that's what I meant.
What does it remind you of?
Huh? The world knows, trust me. I'm making a joke. Once again, ladies and gentlemen.
No, what does it remind you of?
I'm not going to say it, Epstein. Okay, let's move on.
Oh, my God.
I'm totally kidding.
Epstein.
I know.
No, no. This is 20 actors, 10 boys and 10 girls.
I'm sure.
On an island studying acting.
I'm joking.
There were no shenanigans.
You know I have to make jokes.
Yeah, sure.
Come on. We have to keep it a little bit light. But I like to, I want to get into, I'm into the serious stuff because I respect so much what we do and what you've done and what you continue to do. But I have to make jokes here and there just because I have to. So you studied with him?
I studied with him for about
how many?
7 years. I studied with him on the island for a month, and then I came back, and then Sandy moved out to Los Angeles and taught out here at Playhouse West.
That's where James Franco studied,
With
which
Bob
is
Carnegie
funny because
Jeff Goldblum would teach out there.
I was
from
Actor Studio, and then there was Playhouse West.
Yeah.
So
totally different vibe.
Right? Isn't it funny?
Totally different ethos. Totally different
Very
vibe.
Interesting. Yeah. You know, we did a movie together. I act like we're in two different schools. Franco and I.
He played James Dean.
Oh, yeah. No, but we worked on a movie called Sunny, and I was going to mention that because, aren't you a Harry Dean Stanton fan?
Sure. Oh, yeah.
He was in it, and then my dad had worked with James Caan back in the day, and so Scott Caan was in the movie.
Okay.
It's just weird.
Wait, I don't know who your dad is. Tell me.
That's okay. You don't need to.
Okay.
No. He was old school, whatever.
Okay.
But they all, like, that's old school.
Yeah.
James Caan, back in when they did black and white TV shows.
Jimmy Caan, one of the greats. I miss him.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, he was amazing. I worked with him.
Worked with everybody.
I worked with James Caan on Las Vegas. And that was,
Las
yeah,
Vegas.
And that was a treat. I remember... I was in, we shot in Las Vegas. We were shooting at the Mandalay Hotel. I'm not a gambler at all. I don't like to lose my money. And if I go to Vegas, I have a rule. I'll take $200 out of the ATM. And if I lose that $200, that's it. I'm done.
Yeah.
And so I was sitting there reading a book in a little restaurant in the Mandalay Bay, and Jimmy Kahn walks by. We'd already shot like a week together in LA, and then we all went out to Vegas to shoot the Vegas stuff. And he walks by and he sees me reading the book. He's like, "Hey, Shakespeare, what are you doing?" And I said, "Oh, I'm just reading Jimmy and having a bite." He said, "Come on, let's hit the tables." And I said, "I'm not a good gambler, really." He said, "Come on, I'll teach you." And he took me and I went to the blackjack table with him. And he taught me how to bet properly. And within probably an hour, I was up like $3,000.
No.
I was betting like, like the $5 chips. I'm betting at the $5 table. He's like, "Oh, come on, let's bump it up a little bit." And before I knew it, and he was telling me, "You want to hit on that? You want to split those? You want to do this?" And I started making some dough. And then he said, "Yeah, I gotta go. I got an early call, but you're doing great. I'll leave you on your own." And he left, and within an hour, like, all my money.
You, oh, I was gonna ask.
He was my good luck charm.
Did you stop? Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah. I got a little cocky. I was like, damn. I think that was probably that might have been the last time I gambled in Vegas.
Wow.
That was about 15 years ago.
You take $200, I take 20.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you're smart.
Well, okay.
You're frugal.
Yeah, I am very, unfortunately, very frugal.
You spend all your money on clothes.
No, this is given to me.
Uh-huh.
I love that you studied with him. That's really fascinating.
Yeah, I love studying
with Sandy. When you started. Mm-hmm. And it's very strange. It's a strange life. But I don't know. I just want you to understand.
Very strange life.
I'm a child actor. He was a child actor. I'll just tell you that to do what he's done and to be doing, you know, the work that you're doing, and I believe at 45, you really hit like another big mountain.
I kind of got into a nice little groove in my 40s. Yeah,
where you just started. Yeah, with was that first movie back? Was that what movie was that? At when you hit 45, you got, because you were a maitre d'. At one point.
Well, that was during,
because you were.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, you're talking during the writer's strike in 2007. There was a little lull. The writers were on strike, and I went back to working in a restaurant for the first time in 20 odd years. I went back and I worked as a maitre d' at Nick's Martini Lounge in Beverly Hills, and I used that job as it was an acting gig for me. I'd get dressed up in a suit and tie every night, and I would seat people at their tables, and I would, one night I'd do an English accent, one night I'd do a French accent. One night I'd be Canadian,
you can't stop acting.
Whatever it was, and you know, and I was there for about 4 months. And while I was doing that, I got a terrific film called Public Enemies.
That's it. That's it.
And that was my re-entry back into after the writer's strike ended, and I went back and did Public Enemies in Chicago for 5 months, and you know, and that was like just when
five
I thought
months.
I was at.
That's. Yeah. I mean, this is the what I'm trying to say is. It's not easy to be a child actor. I know you're saying you weren't really a child actor.
Not really. I wasn't a child actor in the sense that, I mean, you were doing it, like when you did Charles, you were in your teens, right? You were younger?
Well, I started at 3 and did commercials and then through that. So it's a weird life.
Yeah, see, I didn't do any of that
12,
stuff.
I got that show.
Okay.
So it's a weird life. Yeah. But you were, I mean, okay, well, you
I
were
did a
younger.
Couple of things, but it wasn't a vocation. It wasn't a career. It was just, oh, I'm going to try this out and make a little money.
A friend
of my mom's growing up, was a screenwriter. She wrote a teleplay for a thing that ended up becoming a movie of the week called Are You a Missing Heir? And it was about people who've died and left great sums of money. And there was a role of a little German boy in that movie. And I was always like doing little accents and being hammy and shticky. And I said, "Oh, I can do a little German accent." I said, "Let me audition." And so I went and I took the bus. I took the Metro bus from my house and on the West Side to the studio, and I auditioned, and I did a little German accent, and I got cast as this little German boy when I was like 13 years old, and that was my, it was a terrible German accent.
That was awesome.
But I got that, and that kind of gave me a little taste for it, and we shot it at the Disney Ranch, so we're outside at the Disney Ranch in period costumes, like 1880s, and horses, and barns, and I just loved everything about it, so... I kind of put that in my memory bank, and years later, I thought, when I was thinking about
that's so
what I want to do, you know, I mean, you get to play dress up for a living. What's better than that?
But it's not an easy thing to have. I mean, I don't know. I'm just speaking about myself in a weird way, but I'm trying to compliment the fact that you've had this long, I mean, to have it be, and it does crazy things.
It does, you know, crazy things. It's, yeah.
It's a crazy business, but it's.
I mean, we were all just on strike for 6 months, as you know.
Well.
I mean, you were on the picket line with me.
And
it's funny because it's like, talking about going back into being on strike for 6 months, everybody I talk to is like, now that we're hopefully going back to work soon.
Yeah.
I feel like I got to dust off the cobwebs, and
yeah,
feel like you're always starting all over again in a way.
Yeah.
Getting back into it, I feel like, oh, I got to remember how to act again.
It's been
a while, you know, long before the writer's strike and all of that. I think I told you I thought about bailing entirely and getting
into. That's what I'm trying to tell you here.
Yeah.
And this is such a great story. That's what I wanted to say.
For a brief time, I went to Duke University in North Carolina, and I thought about going back to college and working in the drama department and teaching acting.
But you know what?
Because it's such a crazy roller coaster ride that I thought, I don't know if I want to be on this ride anymore. I went through a really a tough lull, and I was this close to that's what we were talking about
before.
That's
what I'm trying to compliment.
But I was almost, getting ready to bail out, and then I got Air Force One. And
yeah.
That's kind of what put me in.
Yeah. Killer. I mean,
so much of it is just luck.
Well,
much of it is dumb luck.
But
well,
it's not dumb luck. We know what luck is. Preparation.
Preparation
meets
and
opportunity.
Perspiration and,
it meets opportunity.
Yeah.
You got that opportunity. You've always been on your game, and you're so good and so smart and sharp and on it and organized and, you know.
I try to be.
Well, you are.
Any of those things at any given time. Organized? I don't know if I'm organized.
Well, you're always early. No, I mean, you said you're always early.
I try to be always early. I wasn't early today.
So that's okay. This is the Imperfect Podcast.
That's right.
The point.
Yeah.
So you worked with Peter Falk, and I think that's crazy. Yeah. A lot of people aren't going to know who it is because we have a lot.
I'm talking about all these old, like Peter Falk, Jimmy Kahn.
My viewers are literally 28 to 60.
Okay.
If you look at my
perfect.
Analytics.
Good. Right, so in that demo.
For you youngins that don't know.
Yeah.
Peter.
If you don't know, then
check out this movie. It was one of my favorite movies. Was the In-Laws.
Oh, the best.
With Peter Falk.
Peter Falk and Alan Arkin.
Alan Arkin,
who
oh
we
my
just
God.
Lost. I know.
And I love their relationship in that movie. If you're an actor, check that out.
If
That's
you're an actor,
favorite.
Do yourself a favor.
Check that
I
out.
I just went down an Alan Arkin rabbit hole. Just FYI.
And talk about the Falk thing. After.
Well, Peter Falk. I mean, but yeah. Alan Arkin segue. Do yourself a favor. I just watched for the first time The Heart is a Lonely Hunter, where Alan Arkin, an Academy Award nominated performance, where he doesn't speak through the entire movie. He's mute, and the entire performance is with his face and his eyes, and it's extraordinary. There was like on TCM, I'm addicted to TCM, so there were like 5 Alan Arkin movies one night.
Uh-huh.
And I watched this, and Dark at the Top of the Stairs, and or Wait Until Dark, and then The In-Laws, which is one of the great buddy comedies of all time. Alan Arkin, Peter Falk. And so I was obsessed with The In-Laws. It was one of the...
Oh my God, how old
probably
were you
the first... I think when it first came out, it was about 1980, 79, 80 when that film came out, I think. Something like that, 78,
well,
79.
But then that means I was barely walking.
Oh, that's great.
I'm sorry. I don't mean that in that way. I just mean, but I remember liking it. It's such a weird
I remember laughing out loud in that movie theater to the point of being obnoxious. I was laughing so hard when I watched that movie in some little
theater.
It had
to be 80s.
It was, you know what? If only there was a machine that you could look things up.
Yeah, because there's no way that
it's probably 78. I think it's
What am I saying? That's when it came out. My dad played it for me years later.
Okay.
I was thinking I saw the original.
The In-Laws with Peter Falk, and then years later, I'm few years into my own acting career, and I've always loved Peter Falk and everything. And I went to
Universal. Universal
Studios. Did I tell you this story?
No, I've heard. Listen, I've researched.
But you don't know this story, so
I do know the story. Oh, but the audience doesn't.
So Patrick McGoohan, great actor director, was directing this episode of Columbo. They'd done a reboot of Columbo. Columbo, one of the great characters of all time, and Peter Falk was extraordinary. And so I had it wasn't an audition, it was a meeting to meet Mr. Falk and meet the director. And I was just over the moon because I love Peter Falk and I love Columbo. And so I went to the Black Tower Universal Studios and I sat down, and 20 minutes into the conversation, Patrick McGoohan pushes the button on the phone. He says, Peter, I think we've found our Roger, and puts the phone down. The character was Roger Gambles, and he was this very sort of effete, kind of snooty guy, wore a little bow tie and pranced around. It was a really silly character part. Peter Falk walks into the room. He looks at me. He's like, yeah, I think this kid will be just fine. Yeah, he sits down. He says, how you doing, kid? Peter Falk. Spencer Garrett, nice to meet you. Sits down, and Patrick McGoohan opens up a drawer in the desk, pulls out a bottle of Jameson whiskey, three glasses, and he pours three shots into the glass, hands one to Peter, one to me, and says, welcome to the show. Peter says, kid, I'll see you on set. Have a great day. You know, cheers. And like that line in Argo, here's to the first shot of the picture. And this was like at 11 o'clock in the morning.
Yep.
And I took a shot of Jameson whiskey and I walked out of there with a job and a head full of booze. And I thought, well, this is how it's going to be. You know, you think that's how every job is going to be. Mm-hmm. I'm going to get every job now by meeting the director and the star of the show and
easy
having a glass of whiskey and
drive home.
You know, but I had a blast, and I like the best that he had the best work ethic of any actor I've ever worked with.
Wow.
It was amazing. This is a character that he played like 20 years earlier in the 70s, and he was bringing it back in the 90s. And I remember seeing him off in the distance, watching him just off on his own, mm-hmm. like working his lines in his head and kind of walking around. And he was never not working. He was never not in the moment. He was great. He was a joy. I was really, really lucky that I got to work with him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And when you do what he said, you know, what you just said that he does when you go off to the side.
Yeah.
They call, if you're a girl and you're attractive, they call you an ice queen, just so you know.
It's
very
yeah?
different for women, ladies and gentlemen.
Really?
Yeah. If you're a professional and you're off to the side being professional, it's taken as ice queen stuck up actress.
Hmm. Well, that's no good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's very interesting in our business how people are perceived, the difference between women and men.
It's a different
time.
Good
to know.
It's a different time. Yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, it happens even now.
Did you find the in-laws? So I gave you like 3 minutes of
story. Because I figured it out already. My dad was a very old dad.
Yeah.
And he had these tapes and he played it for me. He played all these things for me growing up.
Right.
I grew up with Charlie Chaplin and Laurel and Hardy, and I didn't realize my dad was sort of preparing me to be an actor in comedy.
Yeah.
That was his thing. But you worked with, James Remar was in Once Upon a Time.
I just saw him literally at the Starbucks on Larchmont Boulevard.
If you knew that we'd worked together, you could have said you were coming to do my show.
So I said, I literally saw Jimmy Remar in the Starbucks. And I said, and he loves to chat.
So...
And I said, I can't chat. I'm literally driving to Long Beach to do a podcast.
You could have said, I'm doing
And I said, I've got to be there in 53 minutes. He said, you're not going to make it.
So, I knew something so happened. I'm like, but...
yeah, James Remar is the mayor of Larchmont Village. I see
oh, he
every,
is.
Every day, yeah. Oh, what did you guys work on together?
We did Glozies, this movie where I play an astrophysicist, an evil astrophysicist who works for the government, and I put him to sleep.
You see it all the time. Those evil astrophysicists.
I put him to
sleep. That old chestnut. Yeah.
He comes out, and he's like, well, wait a minute. How do I know she's the one in charge?
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, there are a bunch of guns, you know, on him, and I've got everyone watching, and I'm doing my thing with.
What was it called? Glozies?
I don't want to give too much away, but yeah.
Yeah.
We were at this.
I'm going to go home right now and.
No! You can't. Well, no, it was at the film fest. It's not out yet. Till 2024, ladies and gentlemen.
Did you see Oppenheimer?
I did.
Did you see? I mean, he had a great part in Oppenheimer.
I did.
He's a terrific. I love Raymar. Yeah. He's a great actor.
But he's funny because he's like, well, who's in charge here? And he thought there should be some dialogue or something. I'm like, it's fine. No, they bring you over. Just you know. It was just kind of a funny thing.
He's a character.
She's so damn pretty. I don't know how I'm going to know she's the one in charge.
Oh.
Yeah, he was very sweet. We have a cute little video.
Yeah.
What's funny about we have things that overlap. You talk about the Black Tower.
Yeah, at Universal.
The Black Tower at Universal, when I did Charles in Charge, we were on stage 42.
Yeah.
I had to audition at 12 after never acting ever.
Yeah.
And I graduated to the Black Tower.
Oh, yeah. That's
the
a
Black
big deal.
Tower were the big producers. I don't know who they were,
mm-hmm.
But they were big executives, and I just
remember. That was the Lou Wasserman building. That was the epicenter of show business.
That was scary.
Yeah,
that was insane. Mm-hmm. I also thought it was pretty cool. So Viola Davis, mm-hmm. we were at APA at the same time, same mm-hmm. agency at the same time, and my agent used to go, you know, Viola Davis and Josie Davis. And I'm like, who the hell is this Viola Davis? This was in 2000.
It's Viola, by the way.
I've said it that way since 2000.
If you ever run into her on the street.
I'm sorry, Viola.
Don't say Viola.
I have been saying it. I'm sorry.
And I only say that because.
I've got to get it, yes.
I did a movie with her and Michael Mann called Black Hat. And Michael.
That's what I was going to talk about.
Michael insisted on calling her Viola.
Okay.
And at one point
she got pissed.
She just got, you do not.
I would never insist on calling someone the wrong name. I've remembered her name. Yeah. I tend to forget names and I try to say them correctly. I've already said some other name incorrectly. What did I say earlier?
Dana and Dana get
your girlfriend. All the time. I said, well, Dana. Yeah. Sorry. I said Dana. Pardon me.
You're
okay.
You're
so forgiven. Viola Dave.
Yes.
Viola Davis.
Viola Davis.
Viola Davis.
Yes.
But that's weird because our agent, okay, maybe he said it correctly. I don't know. At the time, Viola Davis and Josie Davis.
Yes.
And I said, who the hell is this Viola Davis? And it was 2000. Well, let's just say now I know.
She turned out okay.
Who she is.
Yeah, yeah.
Very much so.
Yeah.
You know, fences.
You should tell her that if you ever
Let
run into her.
Let me just say this.
You can tell her that story.
If I run into her, I'll say, oops, I'm so sorry. I just injured you with my jewelry. No, but I did. I'm being so stupid. If I run into her, I would tell her how fabulous she was in Fences. And
so good.
Did you know the work of, Fences on stage was so brilliantly done by Charlie Robinson? I don't know if you know.
Sure.
He won.
I worked with Charlie, too.
I worked with Charlie on
a show called Love and War with Susan Day and Jay Thomas. It was a sitcom. It was Diane English, who created Murphy Brown. There was a sitcom that was on for a few years called Love and War.
Oh.
And
my God.
Yeah,
well,
Charlie Robinson.
Wonderful. The late
another
Charlie.
Another guy. We lost Charlie last year.
Charlie, that was really, upsetting. Yeah. So he's a member of the Actors Studio. That's how we know each other.
Yeah.
God, what a talented man. And he's just, we'd go to lunch and he'd be drinking coffee. And I'm like, Charlie, are you drinking water too? You've got to balance it with water. He's like, no, the doctor keeps saying I need to drink.
He was a marathon runner.
Water.
Too. Like, he ran a lot.
I knew he worked out a lot.
Yeah.
And he was at the Pasadena Playhouse, and I went and visited him there. And and then that's actually where you and I met. Was there
at the Pasadena Playhouse?
And Alfred Molina, I know that. They both were up for the same award.
I got my equity card. I got my actor's equity card in a play that I did at the Pasadena
Playhouse.
What
was the play?
The play was called Alone Together. It was a wacky kind of sitcom-y comedy with Nancy Dussault, who played Peter Falk's wife in The In-Laws. Come on, bringing it all full circle.
Wow, it is pretty weird.
And it was about a husband and wife and their empty nesters and all of the kids. The play starts as the last kid has left the house. And they all start coming back into the house one by one, and they all move back in, and wackiness ensues. And it was a silly play, but we had a great time, and we toured. Pasadena Playhouse used to have a summer tour where you did like 1 month at the Pasadena Playhouse, and then we went to San Diego and played in San Diego for a month, and then we ended in Santa Barbara and played at the Libero Theater in Santa Barbara for a month. So that was my first, and I got my equity card
nice.
From that show.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah,
have you done a lot?
Like three.
I was going to ask how many plays you've
three
done.
Three plays at Ed Pastina. I've done three other.
Oh, three. You've done three there.
Yeah.
That's smart because casting people probably came to see yours then.
I don't know.
I would think so.
I don't know. Like it wasn't.
Be smart and do it at places like that.
Exactly.
Not where I did my play.
Where'd you do your play?
In Shitville. I'm kidding. No, some place.
For the folks in Shitville.
Some places. In Shitville, California.
Where is Shitville?
Tell you where it is.
Yeah, off camera.
It's in Hollywood, California, next to the DMV, and it no longer exists.
Wait, what was the theater?
I don't remember any longer, but we did Speed the Plow. I'm sorry, I don't mean to insult it. I told you, my show's a little wacky.
You did Speed the Plow.
I did Speed the Plow, but it was a production out of the Actors Studio, so it was Mark Rydell and Martin Landau.
Oh, my God.
And they decided that I was going to play that role because I had done it at the studio. I'd done a couple scenes at the studio.
Yeah.
That's what happened.
But they didn't play the two guys.
No. Oh, they're very much. I mean, I'm sorry, pardon, the late Martin Landau was not the right age, and neither was Mark Rydell. No. It was Eddie Kaler and Ralph Guzzo. And Ralph had done a lot of plays.
I love that play.
You know, I
saw the original. I remember the original with
he kept saying Mamet was going to show up. So, boy, did we get it word for word. Every little tiny stutter you had to get. And it was a fun play.
It's a great play. Ron Silver. I mean, obviously, famously, Madonna was in the Broadway production. And
everyone kept coming up and saying, you know, Madonna, blah, blah, blah. I want to just compliments. I'm not going to say anything. And then Alicia Silverstone.
The only way I knew
is because people come up.
Yeah.
They're like, are you from the New York studio too? And I'm like, well, I was a member here, made a member here, but it's a lifetime everywhere.
Yeah.
But the New Yorkers were like, you seem like you're from New York. I'm like,
I just remember going to see that production on Broadway, and the Frank Rich New York Times review, the opening line referring to Madonna, and the opening line of the review is, no, comma, she can't act.
Oh.
And it was, you know, that's brutal. It's devastating. And I just thought, God, I hope I never get cast in a play in New York.
I didn't get that review. No, it was good. I'm not going to compliment my. No, I got a lot of good compliments. Well, I mean,
I thought Madonna was actually fine in it, and it was a terrific production.
But nothing should be. It shouldn't be fine. No one should do fine in anything. There's so many things I wanted to sort of hit.
Hit them.
We don't even have enough time to get through everything.
We'll have to come back. I'll come back.
We will. We'll come back.
And I'll dress better.
Because back, he's gonna, he's always wearing a damn suit. You need to not be in a suit
this is
and
me,
be relaxed.
This is me being
this is it.
Relaxed.
I'm that prepared. Is. That's why I'm glad he's like that today. Maybe I'll dress up a little more too. So we will mention he'll come back for the Shonda Rhimes show called The Resident, where it's about the White House staff.
That's all we're gonna say.
Yeah.
That's all I have to say. That's all we're gonna say.
And that's fantastic. I'm only saying what I've learned online. It's safe, right?
Oh, is that on the web?
That's how I said
that's
it.
That's on the World Wide Web? Okay.
I'll tell you where I got it later.
White House murder mystery.
No, it's allowed to, it's technically,
right.
If you look it up, you can see it's about the White House staff.
Right, that's it.
And Shonda Rhimes is
great
so
cast.
Amazing.
Andre Brower, Uzo Aduba, Susan Kelechi Watson, Ken Marino.
He knows everyone's names
Spencer
and pronounces
Garrett.
Them correctly. My friend Catherine
Viola
Carlin
Davis.
Is on it
what?
As well. Viola Davis. Catherine Carlin's on it.
Oh, I love Catherine. Actor's Studio.
We have a very...
Catherine Carlin, we spoke about, she wanted me to audition for the Actor's Studio.
I'll be your partner if you like.
Yeah? You're on. Let's do it.
No, we could talk about that later because we never talked about my auditions and stuff. Winning Time, as you know, Mr. Chick Hearn. He was adorable, wonderful, and... you've all seen
season
that.
Two is out. It's on Max now. Sadly, we did not get picked up for a season three, unfortunately.
Fans were very disappointed.
Fans were very, 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 very disappointed that we didn't get a season
three. The
way
it happens sometimes is that's our business. It's not because
it
wasn't fabulous, because it was.
But John C. Reilly, Adrian Brody, Jason Segel, Sally Field. I mean, crazy cast.
Yeah.
But season two is great. And I hear mutterings that other people are looking to pick it up to finish off season three. So it's good. But I had a blast playing Chick Hearn. It was the role of a lifetime. So I'm very grateful.
My God. Well, we have just a couple minutes. So I just want to see if there's anything you can, I don't want to put you on the spot. Mm-hmm. Is there anything, you worked with Johnny Depp in Public Enemies. Is there anything you'd like to throw out, like any little story or anything someone might find fascinating that you observed as he worked?
About Johnny?
Yeah.
I love working with Johnny. One of my very first gigs was working with Johnny on 21 Jump Street.
No way.
And
for you
was,
young people,
I,
don't
for
know
the
what
young
that
people,
is.
Again, I'm like, I'm
watch
referencing
that show.
All of the Dallas, 21 Jump Street, Columbo, Murder, She Wrote.
Victoria Princess.
I'm 93 years old, everybody.
He just looks fabulous.
I look okay.
But Victoria Principal played my mom on a show, and she was on
Victoria
Dallas.
Principal on from Dallas.
Weird. So yeah. Continue.
We're really
Sorry.
Dating ourselves here, Josie Davis.
No, I wasn't on Dallas. She played my mom in 2021.
Okay. All right. Well, that's, I'm feeling.
No, I'm sorry. I should be making you feel bad. Sorry, I didn't mean to. Okay, anyway, so continue. So Johnny Depp
was
on 21
great.
Jumps. He was a killer show, you guys.
Yeah,
Johnny Depp was on
about
fire.
High school kids going
hottest
undercover,
guy
solving
ever.
Crimes in high school. And they were all in like their late 20s.
He was the hottest guy on TV forever on that show.
For a long
show.
Time. But I got him at the very tail end, the last season of 21 Jump Street. He was kind of, he was already had one foot out the door. He was already like, he had done Crybaby and
he was
kind of halfway into movie star land at that point.
But so, in Public Enemy, what did you have? Do you have any enemies?
He played John Dillinger, the famous bank robber in the 1930s. Michael Mann, big epic.
Oh, I love
1930s gangster epic. Marion Cotillard, Jason.
But is there anything that you observe that you can think of for now? And if not, then you can always say it later.
He's the only actor I've ever worked with that traveled with his own mobile wine cellar.
No.
He had his Winnebago, he had his trailer, and then he had a separate trailer that was just wine, and he had a chef. A guy that cooked, and then we would start several mornings. We would start sometimes 4, 5, 6 o'clock in the morning. We would start our day. I've got a picture of me, Stephen Dorff, Jason Clark,
Stephen Dorff,
Stephen Graham, Johnny, and we're all sitting in Johnny's trailer. And Johnny's assistant made a rum smoothie for us at 6 o'clock in the morning before we went into hair and makeup.
God.
It was that kind of show.
Oh boy, that's so. You and this alcohol everyone gives you and cigarettes.
Yeah. No more.
Got a little heroin in the back. We're going to give him Solomon, just so you know. On his way out, though, let's just wait.
That was apparently a fairly common practice. But that was my. I only had the rum smoothie one morning.
Wow.
So I will let you know.
Very kind of you.
But he was incredibly prepared and professional and great, and I loved working with him. And we hadn't seen. And this was like I did Public Enemies in '99 or something, and then. Jump Street was 89. Public Enemies was 2007. And I walked onto the set and Johnny was like, Jump Street, you played the guy like fixing basketball games in college. Like,
no,
he
remembered.
He remembers.
Killer.
So, very sweet. We had a great time.
Solomon, you can just tell me when I have to stop. What, stop now?
Yeah, let's wrap it up.
Oh, jeez. Right. But I don't want to wrap it up.
I don't want to wrap it up either.
No, I'm just kidding. All right. Well, we know that you love Christian Bale, too.
Oh,
I do, too.
God.
What an artist. Character actor. Beautiful.
Yeah.
All right. Well, then I guess we will have to have you back so you can talk about the Shonda Rhimes show, which is, I'm such a huge fan. That's
Me
so
too.
Exciting.
Me, too. I can't wait to go back to work. We stopped 4 episodes in, and now we're going back in January to finish the show. And we're all on this text chain, the entire cast, and we've been checking in with each other, and so we're going to get to finally see each other.
I'm so excited for you. I'm so excited for your career. I'm so glad we met. And so thank you so much for coming all the way out here.
Thanks for getting dressed up for me.
I did. Do
you have anybody else coming today, or is this it?
Just
for me.
What do you mean? I did this all for you, all of it.
I feel very special.
And you drove all the way out here, and I
really
appreciate
do.
It. I'm so happy for your career. And you're such a wonderful actor, and I'm so lucky to have you on the show. We're so lucky to have him here. I'm so supportive of you.
Thank you, darling.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, America. Stay imperfect.
I'm optimistic.